And welcome once again, everyone, to our Comfortably Disturbing series of webinars. My name's Craig Bourne. I'm a co-founder of AFAN, the Australian Financial Advisory Network, which, as you know, is a business which has been established to help retain the great practitioners and staff who are being forced out of our industry. We believe that we, as an industry, cannot afford to sit back idly and simply watch all of that experience walk out the door. We believe that Australian families and business owners cannot afford to lose the advisors who have been fighting for just outcomes for their clients' insurance claims. And we truly believe that government and our industry regulators do not truly grasp or appreciate the magnificent work that advisors do right around the country for families and business owners who've been dealt a rough blow when there's been a death or an incapacitation in the family. And what we do is essentially keep families off the welfare line. Now, once again, we're facing the consequences for the actions of a few, but this time it's very serious. We really only have about 12 months before the tsunami well and truly hits. And at the moment, we have a couple of choices. Number one is we can successfully complete the FASER exam. I'm told that at this stage, only 40% of practitioners around the country have done that. I also saw some stats the other day that 35% of those who have attempted the FASER exam a second time have failed a second time. Assuming that our practitioners do get over that little hurdle, then the next hurdle is the graduate diploma, and we've only got 5 years now to complete that. The message that I want to make very clear with regards to the graduate diploma, and I mentioned this in our last webinar, is once you enroll, you still only have 4 years to complete it. The institution won't give you 5 years, it's 4 years. And the other option, if you cannot successfully complete FASER and you choose not to do the graduate diploma, and hence the reason why we've invited Chris Martin with us today. Chris is a practitioner here in Brisbane. He's been managing his business, KDM Financial and Estate Planning and MT Wealth for 18 years. And Chris has established a very, very successful practice. And he has done that not only through hard work, but also through the acquisition of other practices, other businesses. And so what we want to do today is pick Chris's brains. Because if you're put into a situation where you have to sell, you need to get that business sale worthy, sale ready. And if someone like Chris is going to be a potential buyer, and I'm a potential seller, I want to find out what is it that a potential buyer is looking for? What are the green lights? What are the red lights? And then if you're going to sell your business, you've got 12 months, guys, to get your business sale ready. So welcome, Chris.
Thank you so much
for giving up your time. We're so excited to have you, mate, and to pick your brains, quite frankly, because you've been doing this for a long time. Can you share your story with us, how you came about going that down that particular pathway?
Yeah, definitely. I suppose for me, when I started the practice, it was, the main reason why I actually did it was I was very, very much over the way in which the banks did it, because I was an advisor at the bank and I never really looked at myself as an advisor. So I wanted to get out of that particular environment and go in somewhere where I could be more focused on the client and less focused on product. So that was, I suppose, the reason why I started that. And then really it got to a stage where I looked at myself as a one-man band, as that there's then certain caps and certain limitations that you'll always face as a one practitioner practice. So I looked around, like, okay, what different options or what different ways can I use to grow my practice, and not only in terms of number of clients, but a number of advisors and also revenue. So for me personally, I'm a big believer in the best investment you can make is in educating yourself. So I actually went to uni, did an MBA to try and get my, education a bit more focused around, instead of just being focused on financial services, what do I need to focus on as a business owner? And that was a very worthwhile investment. So roughly around the end of 2015, I then really started to drive up acquisitions and look at what makes a good acquisition, and then how you can, what's the best method in which you can, I suppose, leverage off that acquisition to then grow the business further. And definitely have made some mistakes over that time, but hopefully starting to fine-tune how that works a bit more to try and then, grow the practice and essentially stay on a growth trajectory from now to, say, the end of 2026 is roughly when I look at, I'll probably stop acquiring.
Chris, you mentioned the mistakes that you've made. When you look at the very first business that you purchased, tell me about your plan of attack in acquiring that business. But secondly, can you share with us the mistakes that you made? When you look back in hindsight, what you would have done differently?
Well, I was actually very, very fortunate that the very first one I bought back in 2012 could not have gone better. It was literally, and I do, after talking to other advisors and a couple that I've purchased subsequently, there's been a couple of errors made on those ones. But the first one, primarily, I suppose the main factors were the alignment between the advisor's way of looking at things and his culture and his values and his types of clients compared to mine were just a perfect match. Right. It just couldn't have been better from everything where I suppose his own, even outside work, he's massively into his motorsport and cars, the same as myself. And so we had just so many things that aligned from a personal standpoint, then also a business standpoint. Because ultimately, especially with that particular business, it was a decent sized business. I was still only a fairly small practice myself. So I actually had to buy that one over a 36 month period. And so that in itself, it was a bit of a challenge because typically, typically they say 24 months. So to go a 36 month term was certainly not common back then. But we looked at it again that he wanted an advisor who was going to go in there and offer the same high quality service as what he'd provided his clients for the 25, 30 years prior. So we were willing to, and it wasn't like, it wasn't that I was looking for the 36 month purchase terms because I wanted to lessen my risk. It was just because that's the only way the bank would lend me the money. So these things align really well. It was just a really good 3 years. And that advisor still actually is still advising today and still within my AFSL, which is great. A couple of the, I suppose, mistakes made then for previous purchases, maybe it again really comes down to like the sums and the figures on purchasing a business are all very straightforward, and they all, you have a set criteria, you plug the figures into a calculator or into that criteria, and that they work or they don't. But it really does come down to the advisor. And I've had a couple that have either, we've gone through the negotiation stage and it's fallen over, or that the purchase has happened, but then things have not worked out that well. And I actually put it more down to that, is the seller or the exiting advisor, are they very clear on what they want to do and like, I suppose, post-sale? And are they mentally ready to actually sell the practice? I think that's probably the bigger challenge. The actual, getting themselves to a situation where, because, of course, typically they're a one-man practice as well. And so all of a sudden they have, they've gone from a one-person practice to 5, 6, 7, or 8 advisors now potentially handling their client base. And it's a big, big shift. It's a big shift for them. So I think the main thing I've learned is to really take that side of things quite slowly and put a lot of time and effort into it, with the aim that hopefully, because I'm very clear and transparent with it all, and we really sit down and nail out that, say, client handover process well, that we shouldn't have any issues issues arise when it comes to the actual client handover.
And you've been around for 18 years. I've been around for 31, so a lot of younger guys probably see me as a bit of a dinosaur. But when I look back, even, you know, 10 years ago, it was not uncommon to see business owners selling their practice for 3 to 4 times whatever the ongoing revenue was. What's changed in the last few years?
I think the big one, so in terms of multiples, yeah, you're 100% correct. The purchase back in 2012 was 3 times. And that may have been, even back then, a little bit under market value, because a lot of it was level premium, a lot of it was level commission. And keeping an eye on the stats, I only had something like about 3% client drop off over the following 6 or 7 years. But again, it came down to, well, because it's not like, I suppose, your traditional business where, okay, here's the purchase price, you hand over the money and you walk away. Both parties need to be really, really realistic on what effort and what time and the focus and the resources that need to go into making sure those clients move over to the new advisor and are settled and are comfortable with the new advisor structure. Because obviously, it's the main reason, obviously, for the buyer is because, well, that's exactly what we're looking to purchase. And obviously, for the seller, they want to make sure that they then get the best out of their rise and fall moving forward. And then in terms of actual multiples themselves, yes, I've definitely noticed, especially risk insurance. If we're talking risk insurance that's sub 100 grand recurring, 2 to 2.2 is typically the multiples that I've seen, say, in the last 12 months, and that's off the back of, 2 to 2.5, that's off the back of 3 small books that I picked up this year. But the big factor on that one comes down to, well, what's the initial payment, and then what's the payment in 12 or 24 months' time? That's the main impact on the multiple. When we're talking ongoing advice fee for service books, it really then comes down to platforms, type of advice, age of the client. And I look at it that probably the biggest change is that, and you mentioned a little bit before, where say 5 odd years ago, you would have paid 4 times for a really A-grade business. You can now usually find those A-grade businesses for 2.5 to 2.75. So, that definitely are the change.
And mate, you mentioned the banks, getting funding from the banks. What institutions are actually lending at the moment?
Well, I used to have all our lending through Macquarie, and then they weren't really on board with our, I suppose, large ESAC acquisition that I made in the second half of 2019. So now we've NAB. Okay. And NAB seems to be really good. They actually even got myself and my business partner, Luke, into a room, and they sat us down and they showed us all their calculators and all their different spreadsheets on what they use and the weighting of the different criteria. Right. And that was a very interesting morning, because it was, yeah, 3 or 4 of them from NAB, and they really, plugged in all the figures and said, well, okay, look, if you are looking to do more acquisitions and so on, these are the variables that you need to really work on, and this is how it would all fit in. They seem to have appetite at the moment.
Yeah. You mentioned before about that sort of alignment between yourself and the advisor whose book you are purchasing. And a lot of it comes down to an ethical and cultural alignment. But if you look at the business itself with regards to filing and systems and staffing, what are the things that you look for specifically there that will help retain the value of the business in your mind?
Well, definitely, I suppose, from a practical standpoint, scanned files are certainly the big one. But in saying that, I've purchased a couple of smaller books that didn't have scanned files, and all we simply did is, because I actually outsourced or have a company that I can outsource all that to, and literally it was a case of that the seller actually delivered all the files and the boxes of files direct to that company, they scan them all. And then I have my staff then enter in all the data into Xplan. And essentially what I say there to the seller is, well, look, I'm happy to organize all that and to do all that, but that needs to come off the sale price.
Yeah.
And it's not a case of that we add anything onto it. I literally show them the cost of the scanning, the cost for my admin's time to data input all that information into it. I'm pretty confident, though, these days that there's less and less out there that are still using paper-based files. So the shift that we've made this year is to actually use a CRM system that, I suppose the way to look at it is that it's a platform that interacts with Xplan, and it allows me, so say for example, if someone came along and said, we have, let's say for example, I don't know if anyone still uses Coin, but that's the only way I can think of right now. If an advisor uses Coin and they have all their client data into that, the system that we actually have now will talk not only to Coin, but also Xplan. Right. So we're trying there to improve our own back office and our own systems that will allow us to bolt on these extra practices or these additional practices a bit quicker.
What are the red flags? You know, the things that really warn you about, really, should I be taking this business on? Is this going to be more of a nightmare? Is it going to be a headache for our staff? What are the things that really stick out from your point of view?
Yeah, I suppose two things. When an advisor's a little bit nervous about the client handover process, and the reason I say that is that, so I have a look at it at myself with my own business, when, because I was a one-man band technically up until about early 2016, because that was when I actually had Luke and Anoma and a couple other advisors actually join as employed financial planners in the firm. And what that had, sorry, street cleaner going past, how good timing is that?
And so, all right, I've got the jackhammers in the back.
Oh, great. So what I did was I really stood back from a lot of advising with my clients and handed them over to those new advisors. And what I found is that I didn't have one client that was concerned even considering leaving the firm, because I had such a good relationship already with them. I could say to them, well, look, this is the reason what's happening. I'm changing my role from an advisor or client-facing role to more of a business administration role. This is the advisor that I'm now allocating to yourself. I trust and I know that they're going to do the same quality job as myself, if not better. And the clients are always fine with it. So it's sometimes a bit of a red flag when you come across an advisor who may be a little bit concerned about the handover, because that the client trust should already be there and should be with them. And if the client knows that there's a good relationship with that advisor, and that advisor is giving the new advisor, I suppose, the thumbs up and saying, yep, they'll look after you just as well as I did, then you're not going to have any issues.
When you're purchasing a book, is it a prerequisite that the advisor stays on in some capacity for a period of time?
It is. It is, yeah. So we do, typically, we do at least 12 months and one day a week. And we're very, very flexible with that. It's something where, and typically what you find is you go back to, you know, say a third, a third, a third. There'll be a third of the clients that literally, an email to them from the advisor saying, say, for example, I've joined KDM. This is their team of advisors. One of these advisors will be allocated to you within the next couple of months. One-third of clients are usually 100% fine with that. And obviously, it's the selling advisor that we ask them to put together this list. And then you have the third in the middle that might need, say, an introduction phone call. And then the other third who will need at least one, if not even two, joint appointments.
Okay.
And so that's typically where that one day comes into it, where you might have four meetings back to back with clients that are doing a handover, such a face-to-face handover. Next week there mightn't be any, and we typically do them as they come up for their 12-month renewal.
And
we like to, or I suppose we don't want to put too much change to the client at all. And so that's typically why we get the admin staff to obviously join our practice as well. That always seems to be an essential part of it. The other potential red flag that I've come across before is when I've been the first person in there to talk to an advisor about acquiring their practice. And the reason I mention that is that it can sometimes be a case of that if you're the first one there and you're discussing how things work and what a potential deal could be that would be a win-win for both parties. And if the selling advisor is not 100% ready, they sometimes just think that your offer's too low. And then you find out 12, 18 months later or even less, and like I said, I've had this happen to me, where they've actually taken a deal that was less than yours. Mm. And so that would be the only thing that I'm a little bit gun shy now on being the first advisor in to talk to them. I'd usually prefer to be the second or third.
Well, mate, as you're aware, you know, a lot of practitioners are right around the country going to be forced into that situation where they have to sell. Because if they don't successfully complete Phasia, then it's basically all over. So we're going to have a glut of businesses on the market at one particular time. Now, I want to put you in a situation where you're still a buyer, but there are five potential businesses that you can look at. What's going to make one business more attractive than the other in your eyes as the buyer?
Well, that's a good question. Look, number one is still going to come down to if I had all five in front of me, which advisor or which practice does align best from a values, culture, and client base point of view? That's always going to be number one, regardless. The expectations of the advisor, what are they looking for in terms of terms and purchase price? Would certainly make up that would certainly obviously come into a factor. But even that would depend a lot on the size of the practice and the type of the practice and the makeup of the practice. Because actually, one thing I'll note is that a couple of years ago, when we started talking to NAB on the finance front, they wanted us to start leaning, because at that stage our practice was roughly 75-80% risk insurance renewal and the rest of it ongoing fee for service. And they wanted us to really start moving away from risk insurance and more into ongoing advisor fee. So now that we're getting closer to about 55% risk insurance, it's changed the way in which we view practices, I suppose, a bit as well. I don't really want to look at practices, I suppose, that have a greater than 50% revenue that is risk insurance trailed. So that would also come into one of those factors for sure. The other one would be, what would be the other one? I suppose simplicity, you know, if the business was ready to move. The final one would be timing. So even though you might have five practices all in front of you, all wanting to sell, timing would really, really come into it a lot. And the reason why I mention that is that, I work very much on the principle of, again, going back to that third, a third, a third. So if we have the client revenue ongoing revenue, and let's say, to keep it nice and simple, it's a 300,000 recurring revenue practice, I'll be essentially using 100 grand in order to put on more advisors and support staff, or at least increase our capacity of staff to manage that book and to manage that book properly. I'll use another third to then hire for growth. So, and you know, a 300 grand book, that's a pretty good example of, okay, if you're using 200,000, then that's going to hire you a really good advisor as well as a really good support person. 300,000 for them to manage as a team of two. They should be able to do that very easily and still have at least 40 to 45% capacity to take on more new business. And so that's why I use that. And then, of course, the other third is used to pay down the business as quick as we can in order to keep our LVR in check. So where I was going with that is really around on the timing front, we, as much as I would like to, we can't go out and buy 500,000 ongoing businesses every 2 months. It's more of a case, or what I've seen the last couple of years, is that we typically purchase one decent sized business between, say, 350 to 500 every 12 months, and then, say, two or three smaller ones, a sub 100 grand recurring in between. And it's because in some circumstances, those smaller ones we can actually fund through cash on hand and through cash flow. But the bigger ones, we have to put on staff. And I don't want to go buying these businesses and then all of a sudden saying to my team, hey, guess what? We've just taken on all this revenue and all these clients, and now we desperately need to hire staff. I think that's a really quick way to fail incredibly quickly. And also, it's going to undermine the trust of the selling advisor as well. So how I like to do it is we might go 3 months out. We'll target exactly who we want in terms of advisors and in terms of support staff. We'll hire them. We'll train them up. So then the day that those clients do then move to KDM, that advisor and those support staff that we've hired know exactly what to do. That they're working at capacity, and the clients are going to be looked after incredibly well. But of course, that then also comes down to cash flow, because then essentially you're covering that 2 months worth of wages with no increase or no real increase in your bottom line. So timing's definitely a big one. If you have, and I've certainly had it even this year where we thought one was going to settle on this date, and then they wanted to push it back, and it wasn't too bad because we're now in talks with another one. But you need to get that timing right. Otherwise, your cash flow can turn really pear-shaped really quickly.
Yeah. And mate, some advice for practitioners who have decided to sell or will be forced to sell. They've basically got a 12-month window. And you mentioned some multiples before of, you know, perhaps 2 to 2.5, but let's say someone's business could be sold at 2x right now, but yeah, they're going to sell in 12 months' time. What could they do over the 12-month period to increase that multiple from 2 to either 2.2 or 2.5? Is there anything that they could do to get it to make it more sale ready?
Definitely. I suppose a lot of it would come down to the advisor themselves. If they're wanting to even stay on within the practice as potentially, say, a BDM or something like that, and they're more than happy and have the capability to give us the time and what we need in order to do that handover over the next 12 months, that's always going to look a lot more attractive on that multiple. If it's so... But my concern potentially with some advisors is that they're going to want to, the closer and closer we get to that date where they can no longer technically advise, is that they're just going to want to, you know, hand over the clients. And then depending on who they are and their age and things like that, they're going to want to go start a new career and go do something different. So that's certainly something that I'm keeping in the back of my mind, that I'm going, well, okay, then what is that new career going to be? Is that new option or new career going to be something that I can, that you can still then give me the time that I need and that your clients need in order to do the handover? So it's an interesting question, or it's a bit of a difficult one because it can vary so much between practice to practice. And look, I suppose the only other one is really, especially if we're talking ongoing advice fee, is making sure that that's really nice and cleaned up. So making sure that their opt-in processes are down pat, their tracking of opt-in is down pat. The amount that they're actually invoicing a client, we always look at it that you're always going to have a few clients who, unfortunately, the reality is that they're being undercharged and that you can't take that client on. And let's say, for example, if it's a group of 15 clients, and they might be getting charged on average $500-$600 per client. So they might be $6,000 or $7,000 total for those 15 clients. The reality is that we then usually sit down with those 15, we explain the situation, and you might have, say, two or three that are willing to go on the I suppose, more, or at least the billing cycle that you can actually cover the cost. And usually those two or three will be the same revenue as what those whole 15 were anyway. So that'd be the only other thing, just trying to clean up a few of those things. And another potential one could be that, especially if your clients are in that older, you know, 70 plus age bracket, what engagement have you made with their kids? And what steps are you doing in order to make sure that you're ready for that generational wealth change? Because that's certainly something that concerns me a little bit when we're talking clients who are 70 plus is, well, who's going to be the advisor for that next generation?
Chris, you mentioned before that sometimes the staff will come across as well from that particular practice, which to me makes a lot of sense because a lot of them know the clients intimately. They've got a lot of experience, particularly with some of the difficult ones and how to manage those difficult ones. But what if you've got an advisor who's in a regional area, so it's not close to your business premises, and you're interested in their business and their business has a staff member, you know, it could be in Maryborough or the back of Whoop Whoop. What's your approach then with regards to retaining his staff?
Yeah, well, it's an interesting one because I was offered or had the opportunity to purchase a regional business probably 12, 18 months ago. And I said, thanks, but no thanks for that exact reason that we didn't really want a regional office. And it was more, I suppose, well, again, it comes down to timing. And we were really working out, well, okay, how could it work? Is it possible? What's going to be the logistics behind it? And are we, I suppose, ready for that kind of business when if we're paying similar prices to a business that's based in Brisbane and doesn't have those headaches? Well, let's just focus the ones on Brisbane is ultimately what it came down to. I'm a little bit more open to it now because I suppose our network's grown a little bit where, for example, we're doing a decent amount of business up in Toowoomba and one of our larger referrers have recently opened up an office in Toowoomba. So that would be something as a really good example of if a good-sized practice in Toowoomba came along and ticked a lot of boxes, be more than happy to do it. And even say Newcastle, because I have a fair few clients down in Newcastle, so that could work really well. But then say, for example, if it was Rockhampton, I don't believe we have any clients in Rockhampton. We might have one or two. We don't have any referrers up there. We don't really have any connection to it. So that would be a no. You know, Mackay would be an option as well. So for me, it would really come down to exactly where that practice, where that regional practice was.
I guess one of the things that we've learned through COVID-19 is just how wonderful this type of medium is, because when we were about to launch AFEN to the wider community, we had booked premises at a rugby club and we booked speakers, and then COVID hit and we had to resort to this type of technology. But in hindsight, it's been a blessing because it allows us not only to communicate with people right around the world, but to consider businesses in regional areas. And, you know, so many businesses now are looking at a very small physical presence and a very large online presence. And, you know, with staff working from home, and using this type of technology, I think it's becoming more of an option for those who are city-based to consider regional-based businesses rather than those guys in the regions just having to rely on selling their businesses locally.
Yeah, look, I agree. And definitely, you know, you're 100% correct. It has made the opportunity, I suppose, more practical, and the potential that could be there. It's just going to, though, be a case of, and really, like you hit the nail on the head before, where if we are going to see a lot more sellers come up on the market in the next 12 to 18 months, I've really got to make that decision on well, what's, I suppose, easier and what's more, what's a cleaner purchase for it? Is it the practice that's in Brisbane that's, you know, two suburbs away from our current office, and or is it one that's a few hundred k's away And if the difference in price, again, I've never really been that concerned about the price. That's always been fairly low on my agenda. So it probably still wouldn't be that appealing for me personally. Not saying that there wouldn't be other buyers out there, but for me personally, it'd really have to be one of those regional locations that we already have a bit of business that we're doing in.
Chris, I'm going to open up to the listeners, and because I've noticed that there's a few questions coming through, I might hand back to you, Georgia, and if you wouldn't mind firing a few questions from the floor at Chris.
Yeah, no, sounds good.
Hey there, everyone. Yes, we've actually got a question from Chris Cannon. Do you need to use personal security when lending, or can the business turnover substantiate the lending requirements?
We've been fortunate that our business, the business itself, has been able to cover the requirements. We haven't had to do any personal security at all. And I suppose that comes back to I've been very, very driven in terms of don't take profit out of the company, just pay down the debt. which a lot of people look at and go, well that's pretty stupid. But the reality is that I'm in it for a really long time. I still want to be doing this 20, 25 years, 30 years from now even. So for me, I'm not really too concerned about paying myself a bit extra now. I just want to throw it all into debt, get that LVR back down, so that then the company does have the capability to go out and buy more practices without having to rely on any personal security.
Okay, thank you for that. For anybody else in the audience, if you'd like to ask a question, you can raise your hand or type the question in the Q&A and Chris can answer them for you. Oh, Chris Cannon has just asked again, where do you go to find businesses for sale?
That's a good question. Mm. I lean on my BDMs incredibly hard. So almost every 3 to 4 weeks, I'm shooting them an email and just harassing them a lot, saying, who are you talking to? What are you hearing? The BDMs, and regardless of who that BDM is, so whether they're a BDM for an AFSL or a fund manager, insurer, doesn't really matter. They're typically the first ones to actually have that. And it's not like they're calling you up and saying, this FP wants to sell. That's not typically how it works. It's typically something where there might be an inkling that the advisory is wanting to move, and then they basically work as a bit of a conduit for us to get our foot in the door. So that would be, I'm trying to think actually, the last ones, pretty much all of them have come from BDMs or other advisors that I've just known over the years. And that's why I prefer to be quite vocal and open and honest and say to everyone that we're looking to acquire, because I have had a couple of times where the advisors called me direct and just said, hey, look, what's your appetite? What can we do?
Yes. As a former BDM, I can certainly say that was a big part of what we did. Yeah. Was connecting buyers and sellers. So what would be, Chris, some of the things that advisors, if they are looking at selling their business next year and it hasn't been something they've considered in the past, what should they start doing?
I suppose really start talking to potential buyers and seeing what's out there. That's always going to be your first step, because at least then you can see who's out there that's acquiring, what their appetite is and what they're looking for. Because I'm guessing most buyers are quite similar to myself, where timing is such a crucial thing. Even say, for example, if I was offered a business, let's say 3-4 months ago that was, let's say, 500 grand revenue, I know that we couldn't really do it because we just bought one back in October. So I'd have to say no to them, or I'd have to say to them, can we put it on the back burner for 4 or 5 months? But either way, starting that discussion and looking to see who's out there, chatting to their BDMs and seeing if there are any guys like me out there harassing them.
Mm. Yeah, good point. So yes, just starting conversations is an excellent thing. You know, just consider your BDM as your friend. You know, that's what BDMs are there for, is essentially to help advisors to grow their business or whatever the next steps are.
That's it.
Does anybody else in the audience have any other questions? Oh, I think that's it. Everyone's quiet today.
Good.
This has been so valuable. I'll hand back over to you, Craig. I've really enjoyed listening to you, Chris. Thank you so much for sharing your time today.
No, not a problem at all.
Very, very good advice from your experience to share with the community.
Oh,
Craig, should I hand back over to you? We can perhaps talk about our next webinar and...
Yeah. And thanks once again, just following up on Georgia. Thanks, Chris. I've known you for quite a while now. We've spoken together at the GenXt get-togethers, and you do run an exceptionally good practice. And so congratulations on your success, and I wish you every further success. But the message I give to our listeners is, you know, don't panic, even though we have been backed into a corner. There are great practitioners around the country like Chris that are keen to talk to you if you've got a good business. We are very keen to talk to you if you want to stay in the industry but choose not to do the phase year exam. And we're hoping that other opportunities come up as well, but don't panic, don't do anything silly. You know, whenever there's a tsunami, whenever chaos hits, opportunities present themselves. And I think what I've learned over my 30 odd years is to try and, you know, step back from the angry crowd, get away from that and have a look around, because there will be some tremendous opportunities. You just need to be talking to the right people. Chris, if it's okay with you, if anyone contacts AFAN and would like to speak to you personally, you're happy that we put them in contact with you or pass on your details.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, obviously never any guarantees, but if anyone in certainly Southeast Queensland is looking to sell, and Chris is always looking to acquire good businesses. But I think the terms have changed. They have changed quite considerably. Don't just expect to, you know, sell for 3 times and then walk away. Those days are gone, guys. But if you can take some of the tips that Chris has passed on today in ensuring that your business is sale ready, you're going to be in a better position. So mate, thank you very much. We really do appreciate your time. The information was so valuable. Best of luck to you and all your staff and your family. Have a wonderful Christmas. And we hope to catch up with you for a beer in the not too distant future. So thank you.
Oh, definitely, thank you.
Yeah, and for everyone out there, guys, please tune in the next fortnight. We'll have one or two more webinars leading up to Christmas. As we said, the purpose of today was to give you that other option. We want to try and provide as many options for you as possible so that next year, even though it's going to be quite chaotic, hopefully it's going to be a positive one for everyone. So please continue to tune in. Please continue to provide your feedback. It's really valuable. We've had some tremendous progress just in the last couple of weeks with people that have committed to AFAN. And in fact, I went into a meeting 1 hour ago with another advisor who has decided to come on board. And we welcome all the good advisors into this group. As I said, as an industry, we can't afford to lose you. Your clients can't afford to lose you. If we do, it'll take us decades to get it back. So please continue to tune in. Thank you very much for your time, and we'll talk to you all in a fortnight. See you later.
Thanks, Craig.